Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, I am Edwin Garcia. Welcome to the second lecture of the third week of this nanoHUB-U course. Today, I'm going to be talking about the effect of processing on the tortuosity of battery materials. On the previous lecture, we were saying that the tortuosity of the battery was a result of the distribution of particles of active material in the system and the contributions to tortuosity from the mixture of the electrolyte binder, electrolyte of conductive carbon mixture, raising with that the tortuosity from having a relationship of 1 over epsilon to the 1 half, which is a result of the different obstacles for your diffusion to go through to 1 over epsilon times nu to the 1 half, where epsilon is the porosity of the pores alone, and nu is the porosity associated to the binder or conductive carbon in the electrolyte itself. So you can think of epsilon nu as the effective porosity of the entire system, raising with that the tortuosity to what has been measured experimentally. In this case, epsilon and nu corresponds to the volume fractions of each contribution. Now, this was done for using just plain theory, using a computer-generated data. Now, we can compare that directly or compare to what you would see in a real battery electrode. These are some experiments as they were published by Vanessa Wood and Martin Ebner just last year, 2013, in Advanced Energy Materials. And you can see here this micrograph showing you these beautiful, beautiful particles. You can see this fluffy-like matrix, which is really the binder. And you can see this is one image. Here you can see the binderized cross-section. And if you look at it, you can see how this structure, as you go through, you can see how the particles are very, very spherical for this particular structure. You have this structure is a lithium, nickel, manganese, cobalt oxide system. And you can see the distribution of particles, how really the particles are not perfectly spherical, how as you go from one thickness to the other one, as you are looking at this cross-section, the battery material is not uniformly distributed. You can even see defects such as cracks, such as particle clustering. All of that could impact the response of a battery. And so you can see it's not only about just taking the powders and mixing them with electrolyte. You actually have to be very careful in how these are distributed, how you put those particles, because they will ultimately impact on the response of the system. What you have here now is a three-dimensional rendering of that particle distribution, also done by the group from Vanessa and by Martin Ebner. And what you can see here is that even in this 3D representation, you can see that particles are not uniformly distributed, and the size of them, even if you assume they are perfectly spherical, which they may not necessarily be if you look very closely, that should impact the result. So processing indeed makes an impact on the distribution of pores of the system, and that may impact on the result of the tortuosity of the system. So something that they performed in collaboration with Ding-Wen Chung was that they determined what the tortuosity that material will deliver as a function of the filler. Okay, and here each of these curves corresponds to different compaction. And basically what they did is they took the particles, they put it in the electrolyte and with different types of filler, and then they applied a mechanical stress on it. They exerted some pressure on them in an attempt to basically compact them and try to reach the perfect energy density or the best energy density possible. So if you do that, you can see that as you put more filler, basically you open up spaces between the particles, leading with that to a drop in the tortuosity of the system. So qualitatively, this makes sense. Except for this one over here, you can see how it goes up and then reaches a maximum and then drops. It's kind of like there was some sort of additional process that that fraction of filler for that particular amount of compaction will, until it reaches a maximum value, and then it started actually following the trend. If you see the same response as a function of compaction for fixed amount of filler, you can see that they roughly follow the same trend. As you compact your electrode, what you expect will happen is that particles would get closer with each other, making that diffusion transport length to become longer and longer. And you can see the effect seems to be going from 1.3 to 1.7. It seems to be relatively weak, but it certainly has some impact. And this effect does not include the effect of the underlying carbon black. Now, really, what we care ultimately is not necessarily about the effect of tortuosity, but the effect on the actual response. So if you see here, that response, you can see here the capacity of the system as a function of C rate, and you can see how, depending on how you change the binder in the system, you will get different types of capacity, and how as you put more capacity, you can see here for zero stress, you can see as you increase the amount of you change the amount of binder, the response of the battery, the capacity of the battery will change, as compared to if you actually apply a stress on it, how it'll change not only the shapes of the curves of each of the electrodes, showing that you can have an actual significant response. So you can see here how a 2 kilobar compaction will give you one type of response. When you put a certain fraction, a 5% weight percent of carbon black and PVDF, as compared to if you decrease that to 2 weight percent for the same 2 to 5 C rate, instead of being able to reach 120 milliamp hours per gram, you actually lose it dramatically, right? It actually drops all the way down to 20. So clearly, the combination of both has an important effect on the system and has to be accounted for. So that's from this perspective. If you go and actually look at what the effect of the tortuosity was, okay, and what this plot shows you is two things. The tortuosity associated only from the active materials particles as a function of the porosity from the particles only, and the size of the diamonds that you see corresponds to how much stress was imposed on it. Either the smallest ones corresponds to no stress, the largest ones corresponds to the largest stress. It shouldn't be surprising that the largest diamonds correspond to the materials that have the lowest porosity, which means the ones that have a largest compaction has been applied to it, as compared to the ones that have the smallest amount of compaction are here on the tailing end. And the color corresponds to the weight fraction of a filler and PVDF. And you can see here, white corresponds to 2 weight percent and black corresponds to 5 weight percent, basically opening up those spaces. And if you do that, you can see that the darkest ones are always down here. Okay, that's only including the contributions from the particles only. If we include the effects, the dispersing effects of the binders in the electrolyte, that will basically correspond to measuring the effect of epsilon nu. And if you do that, if you include that in your calculation, also as a function of epsilon nu, that is the effect of the particles alone, you can see that that results in a very strong amplifying effect on the tortuosity. You can see how for low porosities, the tortuosity jumps almost by a factor of 2 as a result of the binder itself. So you can see the binder really has a very strong effect on that system. In addition to that, I also want you to notice there's this dashed line in both cases. That dashed line is to show that even though for perfectly spherical particles, we can have a 1 over epsilon response as described from the black curve, the dashed gray curve corresponds to what would be the best fitting to the experimental data as it was generated by that group. Now, if you instead make the correction as to not only what the tortuosity and amplifying effect is from the binders, but also actually include the effect of the porosity, remove the porosity associated by the, or I'm sorry, include the associated effect of the from the binders and the porosity, then the entire curve will shift to the left. And to a first approximation, you can say that we can still have a valid Bruchman relationship, but the moral to the story here is that we want to account for the effect, the true effect of porosity, the true porosity of the system, that's why it has an epsilon sub t, and the true tortuosity, which has the amplifying contributions of both the carbon black or binders, right, and binders, and the tortuosity associated to the particles alone. Okay, so here is just to show you one more time the effect of the different contributions to make it much clearer as this data is replotted, how in the correct space we can recover indeed the effect of tortuosity as a function of porosity, and that we're very close to the one over epsilon to the 1/2 response, but we're consistently above the line. For those that are interested on getting the response, the tortuosity effect to be just right, it is very interesting to see how there are some deviations with respect to that ideal, and to try to be able to capture them, especially since at very low porosity, those deviations can be greatly amplified, and we would have to truly account for them. So, in order to include those effects, or to understand those effects, what will happen is that basically just that data was plotted separately by including only the effect of the particles alone, and you can see here how it doesn't happen only for one or two points, it consistently is above that line. And when Tony Chung looked very carefully at this data, he realized after looking at it for some time that there were these pockets of empty space, either because the particles, instead of mixing uniformly, they decided to stick against each other, or maybe because this was a pocket of graphite that cannot be seen from this image, or maybe because there was a bubble there that eventually rose to the surface, leaving that space unutilized. And in order to prove that, Tony went and generated a microstructure that had the same volume fraction of those pockets in that electrode, trying to match also the same type of polydispersity that this electrode provided. And as a result of that, what he found was that it was possible to reconstruct that tortuosity, proving then that not only the particle polydispersity matters, but what also matters is how those particles are grouped and how these pockets, the extra space, instead of decreasing the tortuosity of the system, actually raised it by an amount that, even though for this case might not matter, but when you actually include the effect of the binders, can really amplify that effect. This, of course, corresponds to the average response of the system. However, there was Vanessa Wood and their co-workers were actually looking at the same electrode, but now this is the same electrode now on its side. And what you see here as these particles are being colored is that each section, you can see here, very close to the edge, the types of particles that you will have a different size as compared to particles that are in the middle. It is like when you're mixing and processing this electrode, the smaller particles tend to go to the surface and the larger particles tend to stay in the middle, either because they're not as mobile or because of the processing just make them shear out and come out to the surface in a much more natural manner, right? So when Vanessa published and plotted the size of those particles as a function of a diameter, what they found is that those particles that are closer to the edge ended up being the smallest ones, and as you moved about 10 microns into the electrode, the size of the particles became uniform, as we would expect in a normal battery. So for this 75 micron electrode, what you will find is that 60 or 55 micrometers have the average properties that you expect, and you have a 10 micron layer on both ends that whose properties are very different, and that could alter the tortuosity of the sample. You can see here the porosity as a function of depth, so how very close to the edge we have basically 100% depth, and after 10 microns we have basically reached the porosity that we would expect. It becomes pretty much uniform and then comes down again. So even though if we look at the through thickness, the average properties, and the individual pockets of materials may depend on how you process it, you also want to account for performance limitations or for performance considerations, the particles at the edge, because they will also impact, in the same way these open pockets impact the response, they will also impact the response of the system. Now, here, until this point, we have discussed particles that are perfectly spherical, and we have included descriptions for perfectly monodispersed and polydispersed particles, and even using experimental ones. What you will see in the next lecture is how we deviate from this. We start adding different shapes, and we start also adding, trying to find alternative architectures that differ from this ideal of just randomly mixing the particles. And why are we looking into that? Why is the battery community interested on that? Well, you're always interested in minimizing that tortuosity. And if you think about it, it's a very interesting goal to try to find a material where you can pack the largest amount of energy having the lowest tortuosity in the system. And, well, I'm hoping to discuss that with you on the next lecture. Thank you.